The anime begins with a young student who is being closely watched by all her classmates, who insult and belittle her even to the point of wishing for her to end her life. Outside the school, a strange creature appears, stalking the students, although they are unable to see this monster. Here we meet Yeto, the protagonist of this story, who is a little-known deity, accompanied by Tomon, a girl who is with him and who would be his Shinki, which is something like his personal weapon. After this, the protagonist, along with his Shinki, defeat the creature. However, not everything ends well as Tomon tells him she wants to stop being his Shinki, as she no longer wants to be the weapon of a wandering god like him, and she can't stand it anymore. Due to this, Yeto, after complaining for a while, eventually releases her, and as soon as this happens, the girl runs away happily, while our protagonist starts shouting at her from a distance. Following this, we see Yeto graffitiing a wall with the words, "I solve any problem all year," alluding to the fact that he is unemployed and urgently seeking a job. Shortly after, he sits on a bench and starts drinking a bit to feel better, but then he receives a phone call. Thinking it might be a job offer, he answers happily. However, his happiness doesn't last long as the call is to inform him that his cat, Millard, has gone missing. As a result, Yeto quickly starts putting up posters of Millard all over the city while shouting his name in the hopes that the cat will hear him somehow. Meanwhile, three girls are seen looking at Millard's photo and discussing the strange names people give their pets. They also talk about love and the boys they like. One of these girls, Hiyori, stands out as the only one not interested in the boy talk because she is distracted watching a martial arts fight. Hiyori will be our second protagonist. After the girls' conversation, they all go home. While they are walking home, Hiyori passes by Yeto and they exchange glances. However, Yeto was actually looking at Millard, who was in the middle of the road. Yeto rushes to grab the cat before an accident happens. Unfortunately, a bus suddenly appears. Fortunately, neither of them is hurt because Hiyori jumps in to save the boy and his cat. This, however, results in Hiyori getting injured. As a result, we see Hiyori waking up in her family's hospital room. Her father, who is a doctor, reassures her that everything is fine, and she only suffered some minor scratches. This comforts Hayori's friends and family. Hiyori then asks her friends if the boy she saved is okay, but they tell her they didn't see any boy and suggest she might be hallucinating due to her injuries. Later that night, Hiyori is awakened by floating eyes staring at her and whispering things she doesn't understand. This startles her awake, and Yeto appears under her sheets, asking if she can also hear the voices from the other side. This scares her so much that she runs to a corner of the room. Out of fear, Hiyori decides to call the police to report that a stranger in sportswear entered her room. However, Yeto explains that he is a god and will soon be the most well-known god in the world, which doesn't comfort Hiyori, who doesn't know any god named Yeto. This makes Yeto a bit sad. After a brief conversation, Yeto the girl asks for her name, and after she tells him, he says he will protect her because he owes her a favor. He then jumps out of the window, leaving Hiyori worried, and she falls asleep suddenly. Time passes, and Hiyori has recovered. We see her at school meeting with her friends, although she doesn't feel quite well, suffering occasional dizziness that makes her collapse. In class, she can't stop thinking about Yeto, unsure if what happened was real or just a dream. After school, while walking home with her friends, Hiyori sees a missing cat poster with Yeto's cat, prompting her to tell her friends to go home without her, as she will search for the cat. At night, while Yeto is also searching for his cat, he finds it, but also encounters several eye-shaped creatures that attack him. Fortunately, he manages to dodge them all and escapes safely with his cat hidden under his clothes. However, his encounter isn't over as he encounters another, larger creature, this time in the form of a frog. Just before the attack reaches him, Hiyori appears to save him. She manages to save Yeto from the attack, but the creature is not satisfied and attacks her with full force, grabbing her. Using her knowledge from watching online wrestling matches, she kicks the frog monster far away, leaving Yeto impressed by her skills. Just before the monster can attack her again, Yeto lifts her and carries her away from danger. Both manage to lose sight of the creature, and Hiyori begins to ask Yeto questions. However, he interrupts her, telling her to look at herself because she doesn't realize her soul has left her body. He points to her body lying on the ground. Thinking she has died, she panics, but Yeto explains that her body is just asleep. At that moment, her soul returns to her body. Next, we see Millard appearing at the door of a mansion, and a child opens the door, excited to see his cat Millard again. He thanks the god Yeto for granting his wish, as it turns out that the cat didn't belong to Yeto, but to this child. Following this, we see Hiyori being carried by Yeto, and when she wakes up, she asks him what's happening to her body since she has no idea what's going on. Yeto explains that humans exist between the spirit world and the mortal world, but she is now in an intermediate world where she is both alive and a spirit, which are emotional energy incarnations that possess people and cause chaos. After this explanation, Yeto tells her that she will have to get used to it, because her life will be like this from now on. She refuses to accept this and asks for his help. Yeto takes this opportunity to ask her for some money, and she agrees. Yeto tells her that from now on, they are bound by fate. Several days later, we see a scene where Hiyori is sleeping in the bathroom while her phantom form tries to wake her up but fails. So she goes to wash her head and look in the mirror. realizing that even as a ghost, she can do things as she would in her physical body. Afterward, we go to the school and we see the girl sleeping in her classroom. Her teacher notices this and wakes her up, suggesting that if she's not feeling well, she should go to the nurse's office. Hayori replies, saying that she's okay and it's not necessary. Later, Hayori is in the girl's locker room, getting ready to run an 800-meter race for her physical education class. However, as soon as she changes into her sports attire, she starts feeling sleepy. She notices a small ghost under a chair, which leaves her wondering. Unaware, she'd already fallen asleep, so her friends had to take her home. Meanwhile, she starts jumping over posts all around the city, excited about being able to do such things. When Hayori finishes playing with her ghostly powers, she stops on a post and looks into the distance, seeing three giant ghosts. Not only that, but after carefully observing her surroundings, she realizes that ghosts are everywhere, even in the sky. After analyzing the situation, she explains that the only ones who can see these ghosts are animals, young children, and people living in the afterlife. Later on, Hayori remembers she had a deal with Yato, so she contacts him by phone. The conversation begins with her questioning why he hasn't solved her problem yet, doubting if he is really a god. This annoys Yato, so he teleports to her location. Once they are together, they start arguing. However, Yato warns Hayori to be cautious when transitioning into her ghostly form. On one hand, her physical body ends up on the ground, sometimes in dangerous places, and on the other hand, it attracts the attention of other ghosts who might possess her, making her lose herself. Hearing this, Hayori becomes very worried and asks for his help to return her to normal as soon as possible. Yato assures her that he will do it, but they need to have their own shrine. After saying this, we see a scene where Yato imagines a life filled with wealth, a mansion, a wife, and servants treating him like a king. Hayori looks at him, thinking he's a bit obsessed with money. Hayori interrupts, telling him to get on with it, and Yato reveals that he can't use his powers without a shinki. She asks what a shinki is, and Yato explains that it's a divine weapon possessed by gods. These weapons are spirits. After the explanation, Yato receives a call and disappears. Hayori recalls the words of her favorite wrestler and decides to find a shinki. We see her attempting to communicate with spirits, but with no luck. She then decides to visit the place where Ayakashi, malicious spirits, are most concentrated. Meanwhile, Man fixes bathroom, but after finishing, he lies down to sleep. However, he receives a call from Hayori, informing him that she has found a shinki. Yato teleports and encounters an Ayakashi in the form of a spider. He scolds Hayori for bringing an Ayakashi, explaining that Ayakashi are spirits born from negative emotions. Hayori tries to fight the Ayakashi, but Yato intervenes and his arm gets injured. Yato quickly takes Hiyori's hand and they hide in an alley. Hayori notices that Yato's hand looks terrible, and he tells her not to touch it or she'll become tainted by profanation, which can only be cured by someone exorcising the wound. He also explains to Hayori that her tail is not actually a tail, but a sort of cord serving as a connection between the spiritual and mortal worlds. If someone cuts that cord, she would cease to exist. Then they are found by the ghost and they start running. Yato notices the spirit of a child nearby, runs to him, and forms a contract, summoning a sword as the child's weapon. He examines the child's memories and prepares to confront the Ayakashi. The Ayakashi swallows Yato, but he prays and cuts the monster from the inside, destroying it. Afterward, Yato purifies his wound with hot water and is found by Hayori, who is surprised that hot water was the remedy. Yato tells Hayori that the Shinki's name is Yukin, and Yukin abandons his sword form, revealing his human appearance. Yato approaches him and offers his jacket, asking him to stay with him until the end. Yukin initially rejects Yato's jacket, but accepts Hiyori's, leaving Yato speechless. The next day, we see Yato and Yukin arguing because Yukin didn't want to dress the way Yato asked him to, and while they were arguing, Yukin questioned how he can sense the world around him if he's supposed to be lifeless. Later, Yato offers Yukin a plate of sardines and begins to explain the role of a shinki. However, while he explains, Yukin becomes disappointed in Yato as a god because all Yato seems to do is wander the streets doing nothing, sleep anywhere, or eat from the trash. So he discreetly glances at Yato and asks if he really is a god as he claims. Later, the two of them meet up with Hayori for lunch in a cafe. When the waitress takes their order and notices Yato, she quickly leaves the table. Confused, Hayori asks why a normal human can see him. Yato explains that they don't see him but can sense them even though they are spirits. After lunch, Hayori asks Yukin about his identity before he passed away, but he replies that he doesn't remember anything from when he was alive. All of his memories start from the moment Yato summoned him as a shinki. Afterward, both of them stay to play with a cat. While doing so, Yukin discreetly glances at Hiyori's chest. However, Yato comes out of the cafe and scolds Yukin for this as they share a mind and soul due to their connection. In the midst of their argument, Yato's phone rings and he answers. It turns out to be a new job offer, so the group teleports to a temple where a group of women surrounds them while someone recites a poem. Hayori recognizes the poem and asks if it's about the god of wisdom, Tenjin. He then appears to confirm it, so Yukin and Hayori kneel and praise him as a true god, comparing him to the disappointment they have in Yato. Tenjin asks Yato who the new boy is, and Yato explains who he is. Tenjin tells Yukim that he doesn't need to kneel. At that moment, a girl named Suyu points out that it's disrespectful to bow to another god in the presence of the deity they serve. Annoyed, Yato asks Tenjin what he wants. Tenjin explains that he needs Yato's help to eliminate some Ayakashi, and offers a bill as payment, mocking Yato for being poor and not having enough money to provide change. Tenjin explains that he'll leave one of his new maidens, Tamon, to assist him. Yuking and Hiyori quickly interrogate her to learn about Yato's lifestyle, and if it's really as disappointing as they think. Tamon tells them that Yato is extremely poor and doesn't have a home, which upsets Yato, and they argue. Hiyori approaches Tenjin to ask about the danger of the Ayakashi, but he tells her not to get involved in those matters. The scene shifts to the group walking through the streets. Tomon explains that she found a talisman with disturbing wishes, and when she investigated, she learned that the friends mentioned in the letter took their own lives. Since then, there has been a storm attracting Ayakashi, which possesses people. Tomon's colleague, Mishizane, created a barrier in the area to protect the vulnerable. Yato says he won't accept the job, arguing that if someone wants to live his life, it's best to let them. This angers Hayori, and she scolds Yato, but he insists on refusing the mission. So, Hagiori heads toward the storm. Yukin asks if they should do something, and Yato mentions that they shouldn't and leaves. We see Hiyori attacking an Ayakashi at the train station. However, by doing so, she attracts a large group of them, who plan to possess her body. She becomes paralyzed with fear, and the spirits throw her onto the train tracks to be run over. However, Yato appears to save her, and they both jump, landing on the train roof. As they move forward, they see a possessed boy in the distance walking toward the train tracks to be hit. Yato quickly jumps and prays, exorcising the Ayakashi and saving the boy. In the evening, Yukin asks Yato if he regrets what he said, but he explains that he's willing to let someone lose his life if they choose to do so. However, if it's at the hands of an Ayakashi, he'll intervene. He reveals that if a person passes away by their own hand, their soul cannot become a Shinki, and it angers him that most of these individuals are young. At night, Yato and Yukin sleep in one of Tenjin's temples while being watched from a distance by a girl. We move on to a scene of Yato fulfilling the wishes of a group of girls and being treated like a king. However, while he's having this dream, Yukin kicks him, sending him tumbling down the stairs. Several days later, we see the group gathered at the temple. Yato is in a good mood because Hiyori gave him a plate of food. She reminds him to fulfill her wish to return her to normal. Yukin comments that she shouldn't trust him so much since he can't even fulfill his own wishes. Yato tells them he will use the power of a god and takes out a vase. He explains that an old woman read his fortune and gave him this vase. He then shows a collection of various gold relics, which upsets both Hiyori and Yukin. They end up breaking the vase. She tells him he should work and set a better example for Yukin since he is his Shinki. Yato then tells Hiyori to return to her normal body because he's going to introduce her to someone. The three of them arrive at a place full of shops, and Yato asks for Kofuku. A girl appears and hugs Yato tightly, surprising Yukin and Hiyori. Yukin asks who the girl is, and Yato reveals that she is his girlfriend. Yato then explains to Kofuku who Yukin is and asks her for some money to buy food. She checks her pockets and offers money. At that moment, a man appears and kicks Yato, scolding him and threatening him to stay away from Kofuku. Later, we see the group gather in a house. The man introduces himself as Daikoku and explains that he is Kofuku's Shinki. Suddenly, Yato interrupts the conversation, saying that they shouldn't look Daikoku in the eyes because he's fond of young women. This angers Daikoku, and he punches Yato. Daikoku looks at Yukin and asks how long he's been working for Yato. Yukin answers that he's just starting. Kofuku approaches Hiyori and asks about her relationship with Yato. Hiyori tries to escape, but Kofuku doesn't let her, and they struggle, breaking the door of the house. The goddess tells Yukin that he should be careful because there are many rumors about Yato, clarifying that despite his appearance, he's a feared god. At that moment, Yato appears, interrupting the conversation and forcibly takes Yukin away because they have another job to do. We move on to a scene of a young man saying goodbye to his mother over the phone on the edge of a building. The trio appears to help him, but Yato accidentally collides with him and causes him to fall. Yato quickly jumps after him and offers his business card, suggesting he hires him to help with his problems. The man accepts and offers his card in return. He explains that the company he worked for went bankrupt, and he had no choice but to jump off the building. Before doing so, he wanted to say goodbye to his parents, but he accidentally dialed their number. Yato encourages him, saying it's fate, and asks how it all began. The man says he met a girl and took her to the police station, thinking she was lost. But the girl rejected him, saying she couldn't go beyond the city center. That's when he realized her strict parents wouldn't let her go outside, so he offered to accompany her for a meal. From then on, they started dating, and he bought her things and took her out to eat. However, things went wrong when they went to a park, and everything went awry. Misfortune plagued their outing, and his performance at work deteriorated. They stopped giving him bonuses, and he ended up with nothing. He couldn't leave her, but without money, he felt like a burden to her. Yada asked if he had a picture of the girl, and the man showed his phone, revealing it was Kafuku. This confirmed Yedo's suspicions. Hayori asked how he knew, and Yedo revealed that she is actually the goddess of poverty. He told the man to distance himself from her and showed him a picture of Daikoku, suggesting he cut ties to save himself. However, the man refused, saying he didn't want to forget her. This angered Yedo, and he struck the man, stating that someone who chooses to take his own life isn't meant for love. Yedo then turned Yukine into his sword and prayed to erase all his memories of her, saving him just in time and causing his body to fall gently to the ground. In the evening, we see the group gathered at Kofuku's house, scolding her for her actions. Daikoku got angry and asked why she did it behind his back, but she said she was tired of having no freedom. Daikoku then calmed down and praised Yukine for his abilities, explaining that cutting a bond is much harder than forming one and is one of the most complicated tasks for Shinki. Daikoku took out his wallet and gave Yedo a coin as an apology. Yedo then left with Yukine. Hayori took the opportunity to ask Kofuku what she meant by saying that Yedo was feared. The goddess explained that Yedo was Shinki a long time ago, and when she met him, there were many similar rumors. She revealed that he is actually a god of calamity who kills people. Daikoku threw a plastic cup, explaining that it was back when everything was about destruction for survival. Hayori asked what he meant, and Daikoku explained that the wishes of people allow a god to exist. Distinguished gods can survive on worship, but that's not the case for dark gods. They can't stay in people's minds, so they fulfill any wish, no matter what it is or who it's from. In the night, we see Hayori walking, and Yedo appears to ask her what she was talking to Daikoku about. Hayori asked why he brought her to Kofuku, and Yedo replied that if something happens to him, she can ask them for help. Meanwhile, Yukine played by tossing rocks into the water, and a girl named Nora appeared. Then Yedo arrived and asked what she wanted. She asked him to call her by her name, and Hayori asked if she was his previous Shinki. Suddenly, Nora disappeared. The next day, the group is on the street. Yedo shows them a small Ayakashi and explains that there are barriers that can make it difficult for an Ayakashi to travel from one point to another. Thanks to Yukine's ability to sever ties, he is now ready to create these barriers, and Yedo is going to teach him how. Yedo asks Yukine to clasp his hands and try to create an imaginary line between him and the Ayakashi. Yukine does as instructed and creates a line of shining light. Yedo explains that only Shinki can create these barriers, but admits he is surprised that Yukine managed to make such a strong one on his first try. Hayori asks Yedo if Nora is a Shinki, and he responds that she's just a friend with benefits. Later, Hayori tells Yedo that she will take care of Yukine and provide him with a place to live so that he won't be a vagabond. She argues that Yedo has many strange friends and is a bad influence. After saying this, she hugs Yukine, and Yedo has the same crazy thoughts as Yukine. He struggles with Hayori to get her away from him, and they both end up exhausted. Yedo mentions that every time Yukine has a crazy thought, his neck burns. Hayori doesn't believe him, so they both ask Yukine to choose who he wants to go with. Yukine decides to go with Hayori. Once at Hayori's house, Yukine is surprised by how big it is. He explores the interior and asks where her parents are. Hayori explains that they will be home late. Yukine is surprised that they will be alone, but Hayori quickly covers his mouth. A woman comes down the stairs and tells Hayori that the bathroom is ready. Hayori shows him the room where he will sleep, and Yukine asks if it's her room. She clarifies that it belongs to her older brother, who no longer lives at home. Later, we see Hayori happily descending the stairs, thinking that nobody will notice her presence, not even the housemaid or her parents. At that moment, her parents arrive home with Yedo. Hayori's father drinks beer with Yedo and helps himself to everything in the fridge. Hayori scolds Yedo, but he says there's nothing wrong if they can't notice his presence. Yedo explains that shrines are sacred territory and protect against surprise attacks by Ayakashi, something their home cannot do. He clarifies that Ayakashi are more dangerous at night in complete darkness, revealing that Yukine won't be able to survive a surprise encounter due to his fear of darkness. Later, Yukine enters Hiyori's room, saying that he feels uncomfortable sleeping in the dark. She suggests that they sleep together and turn on the lights. Yukine nervously agrees, and Hayori mentions that she hasn't slept with anyone in a long time. Soon, she falls asleep, and Yukine looks at her and slowly reaches out his hand. However, Yedo intervenes and removes him from the room. Yukine tells Yedo that he can leave since he knows that Nora was his former Shinki and is no longer useful to him. He then runs away. Yedo remains silent and looks out the window, noticing an approaching storm. We transition to a scene of a girl chasing an Ayakashi and using a gun to attack. Suddenly, another Ayakashi appears, and she takes out a whip, destroying it instantly. The next day, we see Hayori and Yukine go shopping. She offers to buy him anything he wants, but he comments that it's not necessary since he can take things without anyone noticing. He grabs a skateboard and runs off, but Hayori stops him, scolding him and making it clear that if he wants something, he can buy it. Yedo appears in a children's park and informs Hayori that he took the day off. They both realize that Yukine is no longer with them, and they search for him throughout the city. Yato explains that he shares the same thoughts as Yukine, because everything a Shinki experiences can be perceived by their master, but it doesn't work the other way around. Shinkis used to be people who lived in sin and resentment, fear, envy, despair, sadness, and greed-fed temptation, an unconscious sense of guilt that masters can perceive. However, he clarifies that gods cannot feel these emotions on their own and can take lives or save them if they wish. Nonetheless, Yukine can receive divine punishment if he succumbs to temptation. Later, we see Yukine questioning if Hiyori is still angry with him. He realizes that it's getting late and starts running through the streets to escape the darkness. At that moment, the girl asks for help finding her mother because she's afraid of the darkness. The girl notices that Yukine is looking at her and hugs him. She comments that everyone is ignoring her, and an Ayakashi is talking to her. Yukine looks at a sign that says a young girl died after being hit by a car while running in the street. The girl asks him to stay with her until 6 in the evening when she'll meet her mother. Yukine agrees and sits on a bench with the girl. She suggests that they can leave together when their parents arrive, but Yukine responds that their parents won't be coming back. The girl becomes sad, and at that moment, several Ayakashi appear in the darkness. They start tempting the girl to sink into darkness. Hayori appears and tells Yukine to use the barrier. He quickly carries the girl and creates a barrier. He reassures her, saying that none of the Ayakashi can penetrate the barrier. However, the girl shows that she's possessed by a high-level Ayakashi. The barrier disappears, and Yukine is completely surrounded by darkness. At that moment, Hayori leaps to save Yukine from a deadly attack, but the Ayakashi continues to pursue them. Unbeknownst to Hayori, she is rescued by Yato. On the other hand, Yukine asks Yato to help the girl, and he accepts, turning her into a sword and managing to cut off one of the monster's legs. Yato asks him what he's doing, realizing that Yukine didn't use all his power. Yato tells him they must take the girl's life because it has been consumed, but Yukine disagrees, saying that she can still be saved. In a desperate moment, Yato finishes off the Ayakashi with one strike. Yukine feels a burning sensation in his neck and drops the sword. Meanwhile, we see a conversation in which they talk about how Yato took the life of a high-level Ayakashi with a new Shinki, and they're ready to search for him. The next day, Yukine is depressed in his bed. Hayori tells him from the door that she prepared chocolate cookies for him to eat. Yukine comes out and sees the tray. He looks closely at a coffee cup and gets scared when an eye appears in it, so he runs away in fear. Hayori hears the noise and leaves her room, finding the tray overturned. At the shopping center, we see Yukine walking hurriedly. He realizes that there's a small Ayakashi nearby and gets scared, creating a barrier to protect himself. He wonders why he's so afraid and blames Yato for using him against his will, recalling the night of the battle. He looks at the skateboard he tried to steal and breaks a window. We see Yato calmly sitting in a tree and sensing Yukine's thoughts, complaining about the burning sensation in his neck. Later, we see Hiyori searching for Yukine throughout the city, wondering where he is and why Yato hasn't appeared. She soon meets her friends, and they all chat about their gaze off. Hiyori asks if they've seen Yukine, and her friends fall silent. They then create a fuss with Hiyori's mother, warning her that she's dating the guy. Hiyori tries to explain the situation, but the girls laugh at her and say goodbye. Hayori wonders if she can introduce Yato and Yukine to them someday. In the afternoon, Yukine happily tests his skateboard, but Yato appears and pulls him off it. He asks where Yukine got the skateboard, and Yukine responds that Hiyori bought it for him. At that moment, Hiyori appears and is glad to find them both. Yato asks her the same question, and she comments that she bought the skateboard for Yukine. While the three of them chat, Yato looks at a figure on top of a pole. It's a girl riding on a lion. She attacks Yato with a whip, and he pushes Yukine to avoid getting hit. Yato recognizes the woman as Bishamon. Hayori asks who she is, and Yato explains that she is a god. He says they had a problem in the past, and since then, she's been chasing him to take his life. Yukine tries to explain to Bishamon that he has no connection to Yato, but Yato reveals that she will also take his life. Bishamon attacks Yato again, but he manages to dodge it and turns Yukine into a sword. A chase begins. Bishamon asks her companion Kazuma to track Yato's location, and he finds it. She separates from her lion. Yato hides in an alley to rest and scolds Yukine for feeling tired, explaining that their emotional state and impure thoughts are affecting both of them. He explains that they can fight Bishamon, but it will be difficult because she has several Shinkis, such as her clothes, her lion, or Kazuma, making her one of the most powerful goddesses. Yato decides to reveal himself and blocks a whip strike, but Bishamon manages to catch him as the whip is also a Shinki. Bishamon summons a gun and fires two bullets. Yato manages to cut one of the bullets and dodge the other. He frees himself from the whip and clashes his sword against Bishamon's gun. She mentions that she will shatter him for taking the life of a Shinki and surprises Yato by summoning a second gun. He manages to dodge the first shot and block the second one, but quickly starts running away. Meanwhile, we see Hiyori arriving at Kofuku's house. She tells her that Yato is being pursued by Bishamon and wants to know what a calamity god is. Kofuku tells her that Yato took the life of one of Bishamon's Shinkis in the past, which is why he's considered a god of disasters. Daikoku tells her that they shouldn't get involved in such matters, but Kofuku decides to help. Hayori climbs onto the roof of the house, tracking Yado's scent, and finds him. She quickly runs over there. Meanwhile, Yukine asks Yado why he took the life of Shinki. He responds that he had to do it. Yukine asks if he'll also take his life when he's no longer useful. Both start arguing and are found by Bishamon, who wields a heavy sword. The fight is about to begin until Kofuku appears with a fan. A portal opens and Bishamon wonders what power it is. Yado explains that she can create spiritual rifts when she uses her Shinki, allowing Ayakashi to emerge from the underworld. Amid the chaos, the lion appears and bites Yado on the shoulder. Suddenly, Nora appears, summoning chains to trap the animal. Yado takes the opportunity to cut off one of the lion's eyes, forcing it to retreat. Kazuma quickly asks Bishamon to flee, and she agrees. 3 days later, we found Bishamon in the hot springs, reflecting on her recent confrontation with Yado. Kazuma approached to inform her that several nearby shrines had erected a barrier around the portal that Kofuku had opened to keep Ayakashi at bay. Bishamon inquired about Yedo's situation, and a visibly upset Kazuma reprimanded her for endangering the other Shinkis. After a brief exchange, Bishamon called for a meeting with all her Shinkis, and together, they set out to resolve the portal problem. Elsewhere, Hayori entered Yukim's room to bring him breakfast, but was surprised to find Yado there. She asked about Yukine, and Yado informed her that he had escaped again. Concerned, Hayori decided to visit Tenjin's shrine in search of information about Yukine. Tenjin revealed that Yukine had requested to work at the shrine, but Tenjin warned her that if he did, he would be called Nora. Hayori was puzzled, as she thought Nora was a name, but Tenjin explained that Noras are Shinkis who receive many names, making them prone to betray their masters and be despised and hated by the gods. Typically, a Shinki serves a single god and has a single name. If they wish to serve another god, their master must remove their previous name. Hayori asked why Noras existed, and Tenjin revealed that they are used to perform tasks that a god cannot assign to their Shinki. When Hayori inquired if he had seen Nora, Tenjin ignored her and asked her not to delve into that matter. Meanwhile, Yado remembered a recent conversation with Nora in which she asked him to get rid of Yukine due to his instability and to summon her instead, attempting to manipulate him. Back to Hayori, she sensed Bishamon's presence nearby and slowly backed away until she bumped into something, realizing that Kazuma was behind her. Kazuma revealed that he was surprised to see a hybrid like her. Hayori tried to flee, but Kazuma stopped her with his power. He then approached her to use another ability, and Bishamon appeared. Although Hayori was frightened, she realized that neither she nor Bishamon's lion could see her. Bishamon asked Kazuma if he had seen the girl, but he denied having seen her, and Bishamon went to look for her. Kazuma explained to Hayori that she should stay away from Bishamon's affairs. Hayori asked why he was helping her, and Kazuma revealed that he owed a lot to Yado, despite being enemies. Furthermore, he knew that Yado was suffering from a curse because of Yukine, and it was possible that Yukine would be killed if the curse was not stopped quickly. Therefore, he asked Hayori to save him. Later, we saw Yado and Yukine reuniting for another job. Both of them stayed to work in a shop overnight. Soon, Kofuku, Hayori, and Daikoku visited them. Daikoku offered Yado a new job, but they were interrupted when Yukine, upset, ran off with the money from the cash register. Yado left the store and accepted the new job. He then asked Daikoku to take care of the place while he was gone and left. Hayori followed Yado and, gathering her courage, stopped him to give him a speech about how he should treat Yukine as a person rather than a tool. Meanwhile, Yukine encountered Nora, who began belittling him. Yukine realized that Yado and Hayori had arrived, and Nora offered her hand to Yado, asking him to summon her as he used to. However, he ignored her and turned Yukine into a sword, telling him not to pay attention to Nora, but to the Ayakashi. He then chased the Ayakashi into a building and tried to harm it, but only managed to make a small cut. The Ayakashi counterattacked, and Yado allowed himself to be captured. He then used a bottle of holy water to damage the monster and free himself. Quickly, he poured the water over the sword, eliminating the Ayakashi in one blow while Nora watched everything along with a masked man. The next day, Hayori thought about Yedo's fight, but she was interrupted by a loud noise. When she turned, she saw Yado and Yukine appear to try to explain the situation. However, Hayori misunderstood everything and struck them. Yado explained that his client was trapped in the bathroom. The client, named Ajiwara Manabu, explained that he needed a safe place because a group of boys bullied him every day. Yukine became furious and mentioned that he didn't want to work with Yado, so he left. Yado seized the opportunity to advise Manabu on how to deal with a group of boys. Meanwhile, Yukine explored the school and tried on a student's t-shirt, imagining what it would be like to have friends and enjoy life. At the same time, Manabu looked at his school uniform in the trash, where an Ayakashi appeared to manipulate him. Later, Manabu encountered one of his tormentors and threw a knife at him to confront him. He approached the Ayakashi's instructions but remembered Yedo's words about not crossing the line and losing his humanity. He dropped the knife and the terrified stalker fled. Yeto commented that he was glad Manabu didn't cross the line, revealing that he was ready to use holy water to exorcise him if the situation got out of hand. Manabu understood that he needed to become stronger. Meanwhile, Yukine despaired over not being able to have a normal life, and Yeto hoped he wouldn't cross the line either. Yukine grabbed a baseball bat and looked at himself in the reflection, breaking a window in his frustration. At that moment, Yeto collapsed and Yukine, angry, began breaking more windows. Hayori realized that Yeto's curse was spreading and worried. She picked him up and looked for Yukine. She reminded Yukine that Yeto had endured all the pain for his sake alone, which ultimately brought Yukine back to normal. The group then headed to Kofuku's house for help, but Daikoku created a barrier and only allowed Hayori to pass. After this, Kofuku took Hayori to the bathroom to bathe with the sacred water from the shrine. Hayori told Kofuku that Yeto needed urgent help, but Kofuku revealed that the shrine's water would not be enough to purify Yeto. Therefore, they decided to perform an ablution, a purification ceremony that required the participation of 3 shinkis, but they only had 2. Daikoku prepared to find the 3rd shinki. Daikoku visited Tenjin's shrine in search of help, but the shrine's shinkis began to question whether they should assist, as they feared being devoured by an Ayakashi if something went wrong. However, Tomon decided to join the cause. Tenjin visited several shrines in search of the 3rd shinki, but he was rejected in all of them. Meanwhile, Hiyori, after purifying herself, decided to search for Kazuma at Bishamon's shrine. When she arrived, she found her and Bishamon's shinki in a meeting, and they were interrupted by a girl who informed them of the situation. Kazuma asked the girl to ignore him, and she did. Hiyori continued to insist until she was kidnapped. Back with Daikoku, he arrived at the shrine without having found the 3rd shinki. At that moment, Hiyori appeared accompanied by Kazuma. Kazuma checked Yeto's condition and realized that he was very seriously injured. Daikoku asked Yukine to take off his shirt, and upon doing so, he was frightened to see several eyes on his back. Quickly, Daikoku, Tomon, and Kazuma created a barrier that trapped Yukine. They asked him to confess his sins to be purified before turning into an Ayakashi, but Yukine refused at first, worsening his transformation. Finally, Yukine confessed to stealing and destroying things, as well as feeling envious of how people could enjoy their lives while he was dead. This confession caused Yukine to return to normal. The day passes, and we see Yeto and Yukine apologize to Hayori while she was in the girl's bathroom. The boys thanked her for saving their lives, and all 3 of them embraced. Naomi can see Yukine working with Daikoku to return all the stolen money he had spent. Kofuku commented that they needed to compensate Yukine for his help and asked for 1,000,000 yen in return. Yeto agreed, which upset Hayori, who began to hit Yeto. We then transition to a scene of the group visiting Tenjin's shrine to thank Tomon for her help. While they chatted, one of the shinkis mentioned that another shinki had become corrupted and was banished. Yukine asked why it happened, and Tomon explained that her curse was too contagious and could infect other shinkis with her presence. When one becomes corrupted, they are immediately banished as it represents a threat and an offense to a god. However, banishment could be an opportunity for the shinki if they find another master in time. Otherwise, they would become an Ayakashi. Later, we saw Hiyori leaving school with her friends. They said their goodbyes, and she went to Kofuku's house, where she taught Yukine how to study. In the evening, she received a message to visit Tenjin's temple. She alerted Yeto to go with Yukine while she prepared to join them. As she left, she encountered a mysterious man, but when she turned around, she realized he had disappeared. She continued on her way. Later, we saw the man atop a building, mentioning that he had finally found the hybrid girl. Nora commented that they would be useful before taking her life. Hayori met up with her friends at a New Year's festival and noticed that Yeto was nearby. She followed him. Meanwhile, the real Yeto was attacked by an Ayakashi and dispatched it with a single blow. However, more Ayakashi appeared to attack him, and he decided to fight them off, unaware that he was being observed by the masked man. Back with Hiyori, she encountered Nora, who mentioned that she would take her life for helping to purify Yukine. Nora summoned some wolves that attacked Hiyori. She began to flee from them and managed to survive until dawn when the wolves disappeared. Nora informed her that a god named Rabo had awakened and was seeking to take Yato's life. To save him, she needed to sever her ties with him. Later, Yeto and Yukine gathered for another job. Yukine mentioned that he had found a way for Hiyori to regain her memories, but Yeto asked him to forget about it. The next day, Yukine and Hiyori met up. He used a sketchbook to help Hiyori remember. Just as she was about to remember, her memories reset. Meanwhile, Nora met Yeto and mentioned that her memories were fading. In the evening, Yukine and Yeto promised to recover Hiyori's memories no matter what. In the morning, they visited Hiyori and assured her that they would do everything possible to help. Then, they teleported, and Hayori followed them to Rabo's temple. Instantly, the battle between Yeto and Rabo began. Initially, Yeto had the upper hand, but he was trapped in a water bubble. Hayori took advantage of a moment of distraction to rescue Yeto from the bubble. The battle between the two continued, and Rabo asked what had happened to the old Yeto. Tsubi realized that Hayori was the problem and tried to take her life. Yedo prevented it and took Hiyori to a safe place. On the other hand, the city descended into chaos due to a storm caused by the anger of a god of calamity, attracting all kinds of Ayakashi. Back with Yedo, he devised a plan to escape, but Rabo appeared and showed them Hiyori's memories. He then threw Yedo into the water, and Yedo tried to recover the memories, but they shattered before him. This enraged Yedo, who left Hiyori's unconscious body in a safe place and managed to strike Rabo, sending him flying. The battle between the two continued, their swords clashing relentlessly, until Rabo received another blow. He commented that he had always waited for the moment to fight Yedo and began to absorb the dark energy of the Ayakashi, unleashing his full power. The fight continued, and both made a slash that destroyed the entire battlefield. Amidst the chaos, rocks began to fall towards Hiyori. Yedo tried to protect her, but Rabo didn't allow it and used his water technique to strike him. After that blow, Hiyori broke Nora's spell herself, regaining all her memories. She embraced Yedo and mentioned his name as well as Yukine's, which delighted both of them. Rabo interrupted them and grabbed Hiyori, attempting to take her life. However, Gano seized the opportunity and uttered a prayer, managing to exorcise the Ayakashi power from Rabo. When he did that, he moved swiftly towards Rabo, and both struck each other, with Rabo being the one who emerged wounded and defeated. After the fight, Yedo told Hiyori that it was time to sever their bonds, but she refused because she didn't want to forget them again. Finally, at Kofuku's house, Yedo asked Hiyori for a coin. She offered it to him, and Yedo commented that from now on, the three of them would be bound by destiny. Season 2. After some time, we see Bishamon having a nightmare about Yedo, in which he takes the lives of all her Shinkis. Back with our protagonists, Yedo receives a new assignment and informs Yukine to join him for work. Meanwhile, Hiyori takes advantage of having fallen asleep at school to meet up with Yedo, and she finds him in a house taking care of a baby. She asks them what they are doing, and Yedo explains that they were tasked with taking care of a misbehaving baby. Yukine picks up the child to play with him, but suddenly the entire house locks up, plunging into total darkness. At that moment, an Ayakashi emerges from the wall and attacks Hiyori, but she manages to dodge it and counterattack. Yedo takes the opportunity to harm the Ayakashi, but he realizes it can regenerate. He carefully observes the baby and deduces that it unintentionally summoned the Ayakashi from the mirror since he needed someone to play with. Yedo smashes the mirror and successfully defeats Ayakashi. The group wonders how to fix the aftermath of the battle, and during the conversation, Yedo finds a mask similar to Nora's. We see a scene between Bishamon and Kazuma, where she tells him that she had the same nightmare and asks him to keep an eye on Yedo. Back with the protagonists, they visit Kofuku's place, where Yedo shows them a magical cat that is supposed to bring them luck. Hiyori checks the amulet and realizes it's fake. She asks Yedo how much he paid for it, and upon hearing the amount, she hits Yedo with the help of Yukine. In the evening, Yukine notices that a swarm of Ayakashi is brewing. Quickly, Yedo hides in an alley and watches Bishamon passing by. Yukine asks him when he will stop avoiding Bishamon, and Yedo responds that it's best to stay away from her. We see a girl being pursued by several Ayakashi, and when she's on the brink of ending her life, Bishamon exorcises all of them, saving the girl. She takes the opportunity to remove the girl's curse and turns her into a Shinki. Meanwhile, Yukine watches the sunset and is surprised the boy can see him. The boy asks if he's a Shinki, to which Yukine nods. The boy also shows his tattoo, revealing that he's a Shinki of Bishamon. Elsewhere, Kazuma scolds Bishamon for having multiple Shinkis, as she is beginning to feel unwell and resolving the root of the problem is very difficult. Bishamon decides to take a bath, and one of her Shinkis seizes the chance to tell her that Kazuma was involved in Yedo's purification, but Bishamon doesn't believe it. The next day, we see Kuba, a Shinki responsible for healing Bishamon's wounds, exploring a forest in search of more medicine. As he collects a couple of ingredients, he encounters Nora and mentions that he has been spying on Yedo, considering him useful for the plan. Later, we see Yukine telling Yedo that he has made a new friend. Yedo visits the Tenjin Temple to discuss the matter, and Tomona asks which god this friend serves. Yedo responds that he doesn't know. Later on, our protagonists defeat an Ayakashi, and Yukine separates from them to visit his friend named Suzuva. Both of them engage in planting and help a tree bloom. Suzuva tells Yukine that he met a human girl named Tomoko 30 years ago who could see him. She used to visit his garden every summer, but she always forgot her identity. They made a promise to reunite to see the tree bloom together, but they haven't met since. In the evening, Yukine does his homework, and Yedo asks him how it went with his friends since he has been feeling the burning sensation again. It reminds Yukine that they can't afford another curse. Yukine asks him if Hiyori will forget about them because they are humans and both of them are dead. She can continue with her life, get married, and he fears they might not be friends anymore. Yedo tells him it's okay to vent and asks more about his friend. Yukine reveals that Suzuva is a Shinki of Bishamon. At night, Suzuva stares at the tree and Kudaha mocks him for waiting for a girl who has forgotten him, reminding him that Bishamon hasn't mentioned his name in years. After these words, Nora's Ayakashi kills Suzuha. The next day, Yukine visits the tree and, not finding Suzuha, decides to go out to eat with Hiyori. Meanwhile, Bishamon visits all her shinkis to ensure they are well, noticing that they are all acting strangely. In the evening, Kazuma approaches Bishamon to inquire about her health, realizing that she is being affected by a curse. Quickly, he gathers all the shinkis and tells them they will conduct a purification supervised by him with Kubaha's assistance. They inspect the bodies of everyone and conclude that none of them are contaminated. Bishamon intervenes and asks what is happening. Kazuma looks at her and realizes that she is not cursed. We see Yeda visiting Suzuha's tree and finding traces of what happened to him before he died. At that moment, Kugaha appears and attacks him. Yeda dodges all the attacks and strikes him with his bare hands. Kugaha summons a high-level Ayakashi and flees, reuniting with Nora to tell her everything. It reveals that his plan is to manipulate Yado into taking Bishamon's life. Later, Kubaha receives a visit from Aya, who was contaminated. She asked him for help with her medicine, and Kugaha mentions that he has an option to assist Bishamon. The next day, Hayori buys some cheese buns. Noticing that she was being washed by Yado, she decides to follow him into an alley and hands him the bag. We then move to a scene where Kazuma apologizes to Kubaha. The latter explains that Suzuha has died. Yeda returns home, and Yukine asks if he can see Suzuha, but Yeda refuses. Bishamon meets with Kugaha for tea, but he tells her that he saw Susanoo with Yukine, so Kazuma is investigating his disappearance. In the evening, Yukine visits the tree and encounters Kazuma, who is leaving flowers. Yukine starts to cry, and Yedo feels a lot of pain. He soon senses Nora and watches her. Back with Yukine, he follows Kazuma to Bishamon's mansion, asking about Suzuha. But Kazuma explains that he is dead. Bishamon appears and aims her gun at Yukine, who confronts her for forgetting about Suzuha. Annoyed, Bishamon asks Kazuma if he helped in Yedo's purification. Kazuma tries to explain everything, but she ignores him and shouts. Kazuma creates a barrier and protects Yukine, further injuring Bishamon, who banishes Kazuma and turns him into a Nora. We see a group of shinkis worried about the exile, as Kazuma used to coordinate everything. Kugaha tells them not to worry anymore, or they might provoke a curse on Bishamon. One of the shinkis wonders why Kazuma referred to Yedo as Bishamon's savior. At night, Kazuma visits Kofuku's temple to sleep. We see a scene of Kugaha with Nora, where he explains everything that happened in the mansion, and Nora congratulates him because the plan is now in motion. In a park, Yedo and Hayori discuss what to do next, but they are interrupted by Aiha. She attacks him with a cursed staff, and Yedo dodges it. He realizes that he is now being attacked when Yukine is not present and quickly dodges several shots. He scares Eva and chases after her to interrogate her, but in a moment of carelessness, Hayori is kidnapped and Yedo is also attacked by an Ayakashi. Kugaha tries to take her away with Aya's help until Kazuma appears to stop them. The latter, upset, glares at Kugaha and tries to use his ability on him, but realizes that it doesn't affect him. Kugaha takes advantage of the situation to approach and use his power. In the end, we see Yeda finding Hiyori's body, worried about everything that is happening. We move to a scene where Kazuma and Hiyori are in a dungeon. She tries to break the door but gets hurt due to a seal preventing damage. Kazuma warns her that they need to quickly get out of the dungeon since they are in the world of Ayakashi, and if she stays there for too long, she will lose her life. At night, Yedo takes Hiyori's body to the hospital and leaves in anger. Kazuma wonders why he can't use his power against Kugaha, and we are told that the names of shinkis are both a blessing and a curse, as anything can be tied to their name. It's most likely that Kugaha changed his name to another god. Hayori asks about the origin of his name, and Kazuma responds that it comes from an extinct clan where he is the sole survivor, a clan that was eliminated by Yado in the past. The boy goes to Kofuku's house and recounts everything that has happened. Yukine apologizes for not being with him, and both set out for revenge. Daikoku tries to stop them, but they ignore him. Meanwhile, Kazuma explains that since the massacre of his clan, Bishamon fell seriously ill for a long time and gradually began to get mad at Yado. To ease her sorrow, she started recruiting shinkis and forming a family. Any spirit she sees, she immediately recruits. However, not everyone can have multiple shinkis at once, as it all depends on the god's power. By having a complete family, it demonstrates that she is the most powerful god of war. While explaining this, he realizes that Kubaha's plan is to carry out a succession. We see a scene where Kubaha explains his plan to Aiha. He plans to carry out a succession and overthrow Bishamon to make way for a successor. To achieve this, she needs to live her life. Gods are born from desires and are, in a way, immortal. As long as people remember their name, they will continue to exist. Therefore, when she dies, she will reincarnate in another body and mold it to her liking. Hayori asks Kazuma how they can defeat Bishamon, and he responds that Yado will deduce that she was kidnapped by Bishamon and will cause a massacre. Yedo meets with Tenjin to ask for help, but he initially refuses. However, he imposes two conditions, The first is that no one should know he was involved, and the second is something they both know. Yado and Yukine, with the help of Tenjin, arrive at Bishamon's mansion. They destroy the main entrance and are received by Bishamon. The fight begins and Yado manages to dodge all the shots, realizing that he has a lot of power without Kazuma but lacks accuracy. Bishamon summons the rest of the Shinkis and attacks. Yado asks Yukine not to hold back, reminding him that they are doing all this to rescue Hayori. Bishamon tries to shoot Yado again, but he manages to wound one of the Shinkis. He asks her about Hiyori's whereabouts, but she says she doesn't understand what he's referring to, and they both continue the fight. Hayori asks Kazuma why the match started, and he explains that she asked Yado for it. When he became a Shinki, he was constantly mistreated by the others, until one day she was contaminated. She heard rumors about Yado as a god of calamity who wielded Anora. Despite their efforts, they never discovered who was responsible for the curse. This made the Shinkis distrust each other and start attacking. So the girl asked Yado for help to defeat them all. Back in the fight, Bishamon deactivates several Shinkis and continues to use her guns. Yado realizes that she is contaminated again and tells her, but she refuses to accept that there is a traitor in her family. Yado manages to disarm her, but the other Shinkis do the same and enclose him in a barrier. Bishamon delivers the final blow to his life, and at that moment, Yukine intervenes, receiving the blow. This way, he would lose his life in front of Yado. Meanwhile, Kazuma and Hayori were desperately trying to escape from the dungeon, but the young girl began to feel exhausted. Kazuma watched her with concern and noticed that her tail was starting to fade away. If they didn't escape soon, she would lose her life. Meanwhile, elsewhere, Yado was on his knees, distressed about Yukine's situation. Bishamon was getting ready to confront him, but unexpectedly, Yado sensed Yukine's persistent presence in the world and summoned him, reconstructing his sword. Bishamon, witnessing this, was surprised. We were told that when a Shinki is extremely loyal to its master, it can evolve into a blessed Shinki. Yado congratulated Yukine and thanked him because he was the first Shinki to evolve in this way thanks to him. They promised to celebrate later, but the battle continued. Yado blocked Bishamon's first attack and both clashed their swords frantically. However, Bishamon was affected by a curse, which did not deter her determination to destroy Yado to save herself. Despite the obstacles, the fight persisted. Bishamon managed to corner Yado and tried to take his life, but her sword became contaminated in the process. Yado managed to free himself and kept his distance. Meanwhile, an enraged Bishamon summoned her whip, unconcerned about contaminating more Shinkis. At that moment, Kubaha took the opportunity to massacre the family, but Aya saw a chance and ventured into the world of Ayakashi to free Kazuma with the help of the tiger. The four of them managed to escape and headed towards the mansion. Meanwhile, Yado continued the battle until he was controlled by Nora and was on the verge of taking a life. However, he stopped when he saw Hiyori. Bishamon took advantage of this distraction to attack, and Yado defended himself. Everyone realized that Bishamon was gradually becoming an extremely powerful Ayakashi, even contaminating Yado. At that moment, Yado tried to end Bishamon's life, but Kazuma intervened and pushed him away. Bishamon, consumed by anger, struck Kazuma. However, he endured and embraced her, becoming contaminated as well. It was then that Kazuma confessed everything he had been hiding for centuries about the matter. After this, Bishamon wondered why her Shinkis kept being, and Yado commented that it was because of Kubaha. The latter appeared and tried to make Bishamon see the reality, but Yado prevented him by cutting off his hand. Kubaha retreated in pain and summoned his elite Ayakashi. Yado confronted the creature, dodging several attacks, and when he saw the opportunity, exercising it by piercing through it. He approached Kudaha's life, but Bishamon intervened. Yado asked her to step aside so that the rest of the family could survive, but she ignored him and banished Kubaha. Swiftly, Yado set out to eliminate the last remaining Ayakashi, summoning a Shinki. He proceeded to inflict several wounds all over its body, ultimately defeating it with a strike to the head. The next day, Kazuma woke up and Bishamon told him that everything had ended well. She asked Kazuma to be her guide once again and showed him that everyone had improved and become more united. Furthermore, she revoked Kazuma's exile. Seeing how united everyone had become, Kazuma accepted to be Bishamon's Shinki once more. Following this, we move to a scene where Hiyori and Yado arrive at Tenjin's temple and are warmly welcomed by everyone. Hayori remembers that she has to leave for her exam, but Yado stops her, recalling the deal he made with Tenjin. He explains that he had to sever ties with Hiyori to keep her away and safe from the spiritual world, so he summons Yukine to cut those ties. Hayori, visibly saddened, reminds him that they will always be together. Next, we see the girl heading to her high school. Her physical body falls asleep, and she notices that Yado is following her, so she starts running away from him as part of a game. Tenjin and Tomo notice this and wonder why Yado didn't do it. Later on, we witness a meeting among all the gods, who are discussing the Amassed One that are starting to cause disturbances in the heavens. They ask Bishamon to begin pursuing the Amassed Ones. She meets with Kazuma and mentions that the masks are capable of summoning Ayakashi, something a god couldn't do as they would cease to exist instantly. Therefore, it must be a god that shouldn't exist. Back with Yedo, he receives a visit from some Shinkis who offer him a briefcase full of money, attempting to buy Yukine because he is a blessed Shinki. One of them explains that a blessed Shinki is the guide of a god, essentially becoming a demigod who protects the god forever. If they deviate and fall into darkness, the god would also lose their life. Later, Hayori visits Yedo and asks him where he got so much money. He mentions that Yukine is having doubts about the proposal made by the Shinkis. The girl approaches Yukine to talk to him, and Daikoku joins them. He mentions that the duty of a blessed Shinki is to protect their god even when they reincarnate, but each one has a different way of protecting their god beyond just fighting. The next day, Yedo receives a new assignment and goes with Yukine to resolve it. They encounter an Ayakashi who is fond of money and tries to exercise it, but it's so small that they can't do it. Yukine returns to his human form, collects the money, and scatters it throughout the city, arguing that a blessed Shinki shouldn't be greedy. He swears to protect Yedo from Nora. When people pick up all the money, the Ayakashi grows larger, so the duo takes advantage and exercises it in one blow. The following morning, Yedo is depressed because he no longer has the money to have a shrine. So Hiyori gives him a miniature shrine as a gift. Yedo takes it and starts crying the happiness since it had always been his dream to have one. Kofuku explains that a shrine expresses the gratitude and appreciation that a person feels toward that god, something that they value greatly. After that, we see a scene with an individual named Ebisu, who uses masks to turn the Ayakashi into servants. Meanwhile, Yedo was escorting Hiyori and protecting her from any threats. Hiyori asked Yedo what was happening, and he showed her a document that recognized Hiyori's shrine as Yedo's personal temple. This granted him advantages, such as the ability to attend meetings of the gods, sell merchandise, and even acquire a sacred book and a song. However, the most important thing was that he now had land in his name. Later, Manamu and Hiyori meet, and he thanks her for everything she has done. She mentions that she should thank Yedo, but she realizes that Manamu doesn't recognize him and wonders why. Meanwhile, Yukine visits Bishamon to inform her that they can now go to the world of the gods without any problems. He also mentions that he needs Kazuma's help to learn how to perform invocations like him. Bishamon falls silent before giving her permission to Kazuma. We see Hiyori at Kofuku's house, feeling stressed due to Yedo's insistence on getting her attention. Kofuku explains to her that she is the first human who knows of Yedo's existence and remembers him. No one had expressed a desire to be with him until now. This is because the major gods like her, Bishamon, and others, don't have to worry about being remembered, and they will always exist. However, for a lesser god like Yako, they can disappear if forgotten by their followers. With the shrine Hiyori gave him, he can continue to exist as long as he is remembered. Hayori asks how Yedo could exist without her, and Daikoku responds that he likely has more followers in the world. Then we see Yukine training alongside Kazuma and facing difficulties in surpassing him. At night, Yedo meets Nora to exercise her. She gets angry and comments that he was the one who turned her into a Nora. At that moment, an Ayakashi appears and Yedo realizes it has a mask. He tries to defend himself but is defeated. Several weeks later, we see Hiyori asking about Yedo every day, as she hasn't seen him for a long time. Later, we see him accepting an assassination assignment while being watched by Nora. Yedo accepts the assignment and at night, carries out his task with the first victim. Then we transition to a scene where Bishamon visits Ebisu and discovers that he has been contaminated. She is accompanied by another god, and they deduce that Ebisu's Shinki are not trustworthy and Ebisu has reincarnated many times. Meanwhile, Yedo continues to accept assassination assignments until he loses track of time. When he finally realizes it, a month has passed and he wonders if Hiyori has forgotten him. He tries to leave, but Nora prevents him. Yedo continues to face the Ayakashi that appear but stops when he encounters Nora's leader, who informs him that they need Yedo's help to rescue a conjurer in the underworld. Moving us to a new day, Nora and Yedo arrive at a cave, preparing to enter. She warns him that they must be careful because Azanami is awake and is an immortal goddess, considered the queen of the underworld. As long as life and death exist, she will live. If Yedo were to be caught by Azanami, he would remain in the underworld forever. Next, we transition to a scene where all the gods are gathered. Kofuku appears to ask if anyone has seen Yedo. She meets with Bishamon to tell her everything that has happened up to Yedo's disappearance. Back with Yedo, he explores the underworld, defeating Ayakashi until he encounters Ebisu. Meanwhile, all the gods begin their meeting, and one of them comments that Ebisu is the conjurer. Immediately, they order the arrest of the Shinki and the gods nearby, specifically those of Fortune, who must stay for questioning. In the underworld, Yedo tries to convince Ebisu to leave the underworld, but he refuses, arguing that he needs to investigate further into the behavior of the Ayakashi as their numbers have increased. Ebisu shows Yedo that he has brought other Shinki into the underworld, and they enter a cave. However, Ebisu starts to feel unwell, and Yedo asks him what's wrong. Ebisu responds that the Ayakashi are surpassing his power. While they talk, they are caught by an Ayakashi and buried, being taken to a room where Yedo expects to meet Hiyori. However, Ebisu sees someone completely different. He warns Yato that the Ayakashi takes on the form of the nearest person who sees it, revealing that she is Izanami. Ebisu asks Izanami if she has the locution brushes, and she replies that she does, explaining that she created them to have friends, which is why she can control the Ayakashi. She asks Ebisu if they can be friends, but he refuses. Izanami, annoyed, comments that then only one can take the brush, and the other will have to stay in the underworld. At that moment, Ebisu betrays Yato, and they both face off. The fight is evenly matched until Yato receives the first blow. He gets up and exchanges blows with Ebisu until the latter strangles him, winning the fight. Izanami gives them the brush, and Ebisu takes the opportunity to take Yato and flee while being pursued. Meanwhile, we see Hiyori with her group of friends at an amusement park, where she starts to slowly forget about Yato due to not having seen him for so long. At night, she goes with the boy to watch the parade, and she wonders what she's forgetting. The boy looks at her and without hesitation kisses her, leaving us with a beautiful scene with many fireworks. The next day, we see Hiyori leaving high school. She hears a voice talking to her but doesn't see anyone. After looking around for a while, she finally sees Yukin and hugs him, starting to remember everything. Hiyori goes to Kofuku's house and asks how long Yato has been gone. Yukin replies that it's been over a month. Daikoku interrupts them, shouting that Kofuku has also disappeared since the last meeting of the gods. Hiyori decides to leave her physical body to search for Yato. Meanwhile, Emisu and Yato try to escape from the underworld, but the place becomes larger and more confusing. Yato asks Ebisu why they need the brush at all costs. Ebisu comments that it's the only way to control the Ayakashi and prevent further threats, something that benefits all the gods. Yato thinks for a moment and quickly orders everyone to escape while he stays behind to contain Izanami. Yukin investigates with Kazuma and Daikoku the strange behavior of the gods at the meeting with the help of Tenjin's Shinki. One of them uses her ability to communicate with trees, desperate because she knows nothing about Tenjin. A tree tells her that they saw Yato, Nora, and Ebisu enter the underworld. We see a scene of all the gods of fortune waiting for the interrogation to end. A girl approaches them to report that Ebisu and all his Shinkis will receive the death penalty for going to the underworld. At that moment, Kazuma appears to defeat all the celestial guards and free the gods of fortune, including Bishamon. In Inferno, Ebisu manages to find the exit, but is surprised to find it sealed. So he returns and negotiates with Izanami, offering to stay in exchange for letting Yato go with the brush. Yato doesn't like this and takes him by force, suggesting creating a new exit using the brush. At that moment in the sky, we see Bishamon, who was traveling to the underworld to rescue Ebisu, going against celestial orders. Suddenly, she sees a crack, which was created by Yato's plan. Hiyori and Yukin head towards the crack, but Hiyori is paralyzed by Kugaha's ability. Yukin quickly defends her, using his power to attack, but Kugaha blocks him. They both start using their powers, which collide constantly until Yukin gets injured. Seeing this, Hiyori decides to flee with him, trying to reason with Yukin so he won't make the same mistakes as before. Yukin reacts and uses a barrier as an attack, hitting Kugaha and throwing him into a river. Later, they reach the crack and encounter Bishamon. Ebisu tells them that Yato is still in the underworld. When they try to access it, the crack closes. Kofuku appears and warns Hiyori that she can't go because she's human. Yukin suggests going alone, but Kofuku reveals that she can't either, as she can only enter in her sword form. Therefore, if they want to save Yato, Hiyori must become a Nora. Bishamon proposes to go alone and, with the help of Kofuku's portals, enters the underworld. Yato was about to give up in front of Izanami, but she realizes that someone else has arrived and attacks him. Bishamon blocks the attacks and then uses her whip, surprised that she can't harm Izanami. So she resorts to brute force to make her retreat. Bishamon encourages Yato, telling him that Hiyori and Yukin are waiting for him outside the prison. This raises Yato's spirits and allows him to break free from the prison Izanami had created. Ebisu wakes up and mentions that the only way to save Yato from the underworld is by using a hybrid like Hiyori. While all this is happening in the heavens, the gods order Ebisu's life to be taken. In the underworld, Bishamon tried to escape with Yato when she had the chance, but she was instantly defeated by Izanami. Ebisu comments that the only way to retrieve Yato is by using the soul's call, something only hybrids with a very close bond to a god can do. The call involves invoking the god by mentioning their name. Hiyori called Yato, but nothing happened. She then tried with Bishamon and successfully summoned her. Ebisu wondered if Yato was his real name. Before they could do anything, the heavenly punishers appeared. Yato lamented never having revealed his real name to Hiyori and Yukin, so he gave up and allowed Izanami to absorb him. On the surface, Bishamon attempted to negotiate with the Heavenly Punishers, but they refused to listen. The group fired arrows at Ebisu, and he used the brush to defend himself. Hiyori attempted the call again, thinking that Yato was his real name since the shrine had been validated by the heavens. At that moment, she thought of a kanji character in Yato's name and shouted his real name, Yakobu, successfully summoning him. The Heavenly Punishers quickly tried to take Yato's life, but Ebisu and Bishamon protected him from the arrows. One of the gods decided to use their most powerful ability, launching a dragon-shaped lightning bolt. Kazuma used his strongest technique and manipulated the lightning, directing it against the Heavenly Punishers. Yukine, upset, confronted Yato for not revealing anything about his name or actions. Suddenly, a portal appeared in the sky, causing an explosion in the forest. Bishamon observed the portal and was surprised that they were using the pacification ring, which was normally used for public executions, but its size was sufficient to take many humans. The ring caused another explosion and Yato, with the help of Yukine's power, managed to contain it. However, the attack was so powerful that it destroyed the ring. Everyone was relieved by this until a seal appeared beneath Ebisu. A time after this, we see Yato taking care of the new reincarnation of Ebisu. Both of them were in a tavern enjoying hamburgers. Ebisu asks Yato why he brought him to the tavern, and Yato decides to tell him the story of Ebisu's last reincarnation, who died due to the final seal of the Punishers. Yato tries to help the new Ebisu recover his memories, but his efforts prove futile. Unintentionally, Yato recalls the death of the previous Ebisu, whose body exploded in front of him due to the sacred power of the Punishers. Yato confesses his feelings of guilt for not having saved him, despite it being his duty as a god. Later on, we see Bishamon gathering with the only Shinkis who survived the Punisher's attack. One of them mentions that Ebisu's goal was to obtain the brush, but it disappeared after the explosion. At night, Yato and Yukine arrive at a bridge, where Yato shares his story as the god of calamity. He confesses that he no longer wishes to return to that stage and prefers to be a god who seeks the happiness of humans, following Ebisu's example. At that moment, Nora appears to ask Yato to leave. He asks her if Ebisu was executed by his father, to which she confirms. Yato becomes furious and decides to set her free. Yato wonders what he should do if he wants to be a god who brings happiness, even though all he knows is taking lives. Yukine suggests that he can eliminate Ayakashi to keep people safe, thus achieving his goal of being the god he wants to be. This motivates Yato, and together they head towards a storm of Ayakashi to resolve the situation.